Here are the 10 knitting podcasts that I like the most. Hi, hello, my name is Allie, and this is my channel where I talk about what I'm knitting, how it's going, and what it's costing me. And today, instead of the standard knitting podcast format, I actually want to get into other knitting podcasts. I want to talk about some of my favorites because I only started one of these because I watched other people's. In the same way that I think it's kind of cool to think about the fact that we who are currently knitting are knitting in the tradition of the ancestors who came before us, I'm also sitting here recording this podcast in the tradition of all the knitting podcasters who sat down and recorded before me. And I feel like it's only fair to, in part, return that favor by talking about some of those podcasts here and a little bit paying it forward by talking about some of the ones that have popped up since. So if you're looking for some new knitting podcasts to round out your YouTube experience, then stay tuned. So I'm a full-time freelance graphic designer coming to you from just outside Toronto. And today, continuing the spooky season theme of mugs on the channel, this is my ghost mug from Indigo. Isn't he cute? Look at him. And in this mug today, I'm trying something new, actually. So Keats & Co. was nice enough to send me a sample pack of their different teas. So today I'm trying their chai, and it's such a good, like, rich, spicy chai. Like, it actually kind of pains me that I made this tea and now I'm about to sit here recording a podcast instead of just, like, curling up under a blanket and, like, maybe watching the Halloween Town movies. That's kind of what I want to be doing right now. So this is not sponsored, but Keats & Co. did send me a sample pack of some of their teas, and I do have an affiliate code. So if you want to get 25% off, because if you're going to buy it, why would you not want 25% off? You can use my code Allison Rowan. And if you're feeling a little bit guilty spending money buying yourself nice tea, you can feel a little bit less guilty because 100% of their profits actually go to charity. So you're not just treating yourself, you're also helping to support equitable access to cures for tuberculosis worldwide. So good for you. As for what I'm wearing today, this is my Cloud Bow top by Reed Keys that I finished this summer, layered over my Fausta top by Loki Bold Knit. So we're actually double representing on the past knits front today. I realized that my Fausta top could work as the top that needs to go under my Cloud Bow because obviously it's very sheer. And I was just so impressed by how well it worked underneath. Like, let me stand up a little so you can get the full effect. But I just think that this really straight across neckline with the straps just looks really cute layered under the Cloud Bow. Now, when I revisit old knits on the channel, I do like to check up on how they're doing as far as getting wear in my wardrobe and how that value is working out over time. So this Cloud Bow top I finished, I think, early this summer, and between the pattern cost and the yarn cost, this project cost me $130 Canadian, and this is my fifth time wearing it. So that puts us at about a $25 Canadian cost per wear, or about $19 US, which, I mean, that's high. That's a high cost per wear. And this is also definitely not like a daily wear kind of garment. You know, this is not a neutral. This is not a basic. It also is very kind of particular to certain weather conditions. You know, the mohair that it's knit out of is not super conducive to wearing it in really hot weather, but also obviously something this open is also not super well equipped to handle really cold weather either. So, I mean, I think I knew when I knit this that it was never going to be my most sort of cost-effective, high-value, high-wear piece in my wardrobe. It was really more about, I really like this yarn, I would really like to do something with it. But so it's definitely gonna take a bit before this reaches what I would consider to be like a good cost per wear. And then the Fausta top I finished even more recently. It was just finished at the very end of August. And this one cost me $75 Canadian. And this is my third time wearing it. So it's also at $25 Canadian per wear, or about $19 US. But I do kind of have higher hopes for this one reaching a better cost per wear, both because, I mean, it's starting at like half the cost of the Cloud Bow to begin with, but it also is just more of kind of a basic top. You know, it's a cute tank top that works well as both like a dressy-ish feeling shirt in hot weather, and also, as we can see, layers well. So I do think that this one is probably going to reach a pretty good cost per wear relatively quickly. It just hasn't had a lot of time to do that because I only finished it just over a month ago and we're going into fall. So you know what? It's not really its main season, but it's still getting wear. So I think this one is gonna fare pretty well in the wardrobe, but we'll keep checking in on it. Okay, let's get into podcasts. So as I was making the list of podcasts that I wanna talk about, I was kind of thinking about how do I organize this in a way that gives you information that will be helpful to assess whether this is going to be a channel that might be a good fit for you without you having to like go watch an entire episode to find out, because I think that there are a lot of different factors that make different channels more or less appealing or even just useful to us. So for all these channels, I'm going to be talking about where they're located, because I feel like climate can have a really sort of undervalued impact on the kind of things that knitting podcasters are going to be knitting. And maybe someone in a similar climate to you might be talking about things that appeal to you more, or maybe you're sick and tired of the kind of things that people knit in your climate and you'd like to watch what people knit who are living in different kinds of places. I'm also going to be mentioning the sizes of the patterns that these knitters tend to be knitting. I think that can be a really helpful reference as far as what things might look like on a body like yours, or how the knitting experience might vary when knitting for a body more closer to yours. And I'm also going to mention their current subscriber count, because I think that can be a helpful gauge of if you're looking to find a podcast that's kind of new and upcoming, or if you're looking to find one that has a large audience base, and maybe that means there's a higher likelihood that it might appeal to you. And with each of these, I'm also going to pop in just a short little clip of them kind of introducing one of their recent episodes, just so you can get a quick impression, because I feel like you can glean a lot from not a lot of video, just of like whether you're going to jive with somebody, as evidenced by the fact that, I mean, I've gotten like several comments complaining that I talk too fast, but as many of those comments I've gotten just as many saying that they really like how fast I talk and the pace of my videos. So here we are, to each their own. Maybe I'll also try to pop in some screenshots of their Ravelry project pages just to give you kind of a visual overview of the kind of stuff that they knit, because I think that that can be a relevant factor too. But first and foremost, I've kind of decided to categorize all of these as superlatives, because as I was going through this list, I was trying to kind of think about, you know, how can I describe kind of what makes each of them unique and distinct from each other to kind of give you a sense of which of these appeal to you in the event that you're not actually interested in watching an entire hour-long episode from 10 different podcasters right now. So we're taking it back to yearbook, to prom. We're doing superlatives. Best of, most likely to. So here we go. Here are the 10 knitting podcasts that I like the most and hope that you will too. Okay, first up for our superlatives, most likely to be the first podcast I watch, and that is Me Knits. So Amy's based, I believe, in Boston, and she's the biggest channel on my list. She currently has 30,000 subscribers, and she's usually knitting around a size small, and she's also often doing mods to account for the fact that she's short. So she's doing kind of like petite style modifications.
Hi everyone, welcome to or welcome back to my channel, Knee Knits. My name is Amy and here I talk about all things knitting, and today is podcast episode number 45 where I'll be sharing what I've been knitting for the past few weeks.
So Amy's podcast is one of the ones that I've been watching the longest, and she is like for sure the fastest one that I click on the vast majority of the time. I have a hard time quite pinpointing like what it is exactly that I like about her channel so much. I think that so much of not just knitting podcasts, but I listen to a lot of regular podcasts in general during the day while I work, because a lot of my work as a graphic designer is so visual that there's space in the brain for other things to be going on. So I listen to a lot of podcasts, and I find it really hard to find new podcasts just by looking in sort of a topic-based way, because for me, so much of it is just a vibe. Like, do you feel like you would be friends with this person? Do you want to sit there and listen to them talk? And I just think that in that way, Amy is just such a good fit for me. I just really enjoy the way that she talks. I just feel like I could listen to her forever. I don't think her podcast is very highly edited. Like, I do a lot of jump cuts because I am a mess when I'm recording. Hers is not like that, but at the same time, it is still very sort of organized and focused, and she is just really good off the cuff at doing this. So I truly don't know. I feel like with a lot of the other podcasts on this list, I can kind of pinpoint specific things about them that I like. With Amy, I just like Amy. I don't know what to tell you. And in terms of what she knits, she is knitting a lot of popular patterns, particularly petite knit. And so along those lines, a lot of what she knits is sort of plain stockinette in different solids. She does kind of a combo of neutrals, but also a lot of jewel tones, and then the kind of occasional like pop color. And she also does a decent amount of sort of classic textured pieces. So sort of all over rib pieces or like cabled sweaters and things like that. It's a very sort of classic polished aesthetic, like very much the kind of knits that you would be like, yeah, you're still gonna have those in your closet in 50 years, probably. And in addition to the normal knitting podcast format, she's also done some really great tier ranking videos. I think she's tier ranked different yarns. She's tier ranked all of the petite knit patterns that she's knit. So those are some really fun videos to go check out if you want to get a sense both of her vibe, but also like really kind of maybe get some new information at the same time. All right, next up on the list, this is the podcast with what I would call the best overall quality. Like, someone get this girl an Emmy for her work, because I've never seen a more perfect knitting podcast. So I'm talking about Nora from AKA Nora Knits. Nora's from Connecticut. She's usually knitting between sort of a large and an extra large, and her channel currently has about 11,000 subscribers. And I've never seen anyone put more effort into making like the best possible knitting podcast.
Hello there, I'm Nora, and you're watching, also known as Nora Knits. Thank you so much for joining me for another podcast episode today.
Her attention to detail is just impeccable. And okay, honestly, like before I elaborate on that, I feel like I should also say, like, she is a delight. Like, Nora's podcast could be filmed on a potato and I would still love watching Nora's podcast. I love Nora's podcast for Nora 100%. Just in a roundup situation where I'm trying to distinguish her from other people, the clearest way for me to do that is that she deserves an Emmy. Her podcasts are shot beautifully. She always has seasonal decor changing out in the background. She does a fantastic job of showing garments in her videos, like the way that she models them, so you can really see what's going on. She also puts all the details of everything in text on the screen, so you can see all the details of the pattern, the yarns, the needles, everything you could ever want to know is there. You don't have to go back and try to find the part of the video where she says it. Like, I've just never seen a more visually perfect YouTube podcast. Just so good. She also has an adorable dog named OC who likes to like run up and down the stairs that are in the background of her shot while she's filming. I also think one of the things that I really appreciate about Nora's channel is that she, like me, I would say, is a very adventurous beginner. So she hasn't been knitting very long either. Actually, I think she's been knitting for less time than I have, but she really does not let that hold her back in terms of what she chooses to knit. She's also often knitting patterns that I have never heard of before. She's not knitting what everybody else is knitting. She's finding things like down in the depths of Ravelry. She is modifying them within an inch of their life. She is just knitting whatever she wants, and she's figuring out whatever she needs to figure out to make that happen. And I relate to that attitude. So, like, I don't believe in waiting until you're like ready and like fully equipped and qualified to knit something. I think it depends a lot on your personality, but if you're someone who wouldn't be crushed by having to go back and redo something because you didn't get it right the first time, do it. You'll learn so much more for having done that. And I feel like Nora is just the epitome of that. Okay, next up we have Funniest Podcast. And for this we have The Black Sheep Knitter. So Sarah's based in Madison, Wisconsin. She has about 8,000 subscribers right now, and I think she's generally knitting around a size large.
Hello, and welcome to episode 7 of the Black Sheep Knitter podcast. My name is Sarah, and I am coming to you from a wintry mix, but sunny, here in Madison, Wisconsin.
Now here's the thing. This could also be classified as one of the most sporadic knitting podcasts because her last episode was 4 weeks ago, but her last one before that was, I think, 8 or 9 months ago. So we're not blessed with the Black Sheep Knitter videos on the regular. We are blessed with them when we deserve them. So it's not always predictable when we will get episodes of the Black Sheep Knitter, but it is predictable that they will be such a delight. Like, first of all, these episodes tend to be like 1.5 to 2 hours long. And like, I just have the best time the whole time. Like, Sarah just has the best sense of humor, and it just feels like she's having the best time sitting there talking to you for 2 hours. And it's just, it's so good. Like, it's kind of the feeling of like when you meet up for coffee with a friend you haven't seen in a really long time, but then you pick up like no time has passed and it's just the best conversation. Like, that is kind of the feeling. Months will go by and I will see that suddenly there's a new episode that's 2 hours long, and I'm like, clear my afternoon. I just want to sit on the couch and knit and hang out with Sarah because I've missed her and I don't know when we're gonna get to do this again. And it's gonna be the best time. She also works with lots of super fun yarns. She likes to work with bright colors. She likes to work with really funky yarns with a lot of variegation going on. And she also knits a lot of shawls, which are not a thing that I like to knit, but I do love to watch her talk about them, in part because they tend to be so kind of complex and intricate. And that's just not really the nature of most things that I'm knitting. So it's just very interesting to me to hear her talk about the process of those and just to see them coming together. So I hope that Sarah's next episode is sooner than later, but whenever we are blessed with a new episode, I will be there because she is one of my absolute favorites. All right, next up, we have our most financially conscious podcast. So this is String Things by Mel. Mel is based in Vancouver, British Columbia. She has about 9,000 subscribers on her channel, and she is generally knitting around a size extra small, small, or children's stuff for her daughter, who's I think like 3, 4, somewhere around there.
Hey there, welcome or welcome back to my channel, String Things by Mel. My name is Melissa. I'm a stay-at-home mom living in Vancouver, Canada, and on my channel, I chat and share everything about my knitting hobby.
And Mel is honestly one of the people who inspired me in making my channel to want to talk very openly about the finances of it, because that's something she does on her channel. She's very consistent in talking about the costs that go into these projects, which I think can be very easy to kind of forget about when you're just watching knitting podcasts, and especially when you're watching channels where people have a lot of time to be knitting really high volumes of stuff, to just lose track of just how much money we're talking about, particularly when these things are being knit out of like high quality natural fibers, right? This stuff is not cheap. So I really love that Mel really lays that out and gets into the details of that pricing and all of her stuff. She also has a cat named Tiberius who likes to make appearances, and I also appreciate that. In terms of what she's knitting, she does a lot of garments, and sort of like half of them are very neutral, while the other half is kind of like fun, bright colors. But overall, it's mostly solid colors and quite a few stripes. And then, like I said, she also has a young daughter who she knits a lot of stuff for. So if you're interested in knitting for kids, she definitely has that going for her too. Mel also has just sort of a really nice, like, laid back and relaxed tone that I really appreciate. Like, hers is one of my favorite podcasts to put on sometimes when I'm not actually sitting there knitting, but I'm instead just kind of wandering around doing things in the house, like maybe doing dishes or whatever. And I can sort of look over and peek at what she's showing when she's showing something new. But then she can just kind of keep me company while I'm going about doing stuff. And it just makes for a really nice, like, calming atmosphere. All right, next up we have Most Colorful. So this is Sarah Lily Makes. She currently has about 2,000 subscribers, and she's generally knitting around a size medium, but also she's knitting all kinds of kids' clothes. Like, I think her kids range in age from like toddler to graduating high school. So she's really knitting a broad range.
Hi, welcome or welcome back to Sarah Lily Makes. My name is Sarah, and this is my journaling space here on YouTube, where I like to document and share all the things that I have been making.
Now, similar to Strings and Things by Mel, Sarah Lily Makes is also a very sort of chill, laid back vibe. It's just so peaceful in a way that, like, I don't think anyone would ever describe my channel as peaceful. Anyway, Sarah's knits are just such eye candy. Like, she does a lot with pastels, and she also does quite a bit with variegated yarns, but she is actually the one that I fully blame for gaining any interest whatsoever in variegated yarns, because before I started watching her channel, I never really liked anything I saw that was made out of variegated yarns, and she is the one who made me realize that I do like them. I just have very specific criteria for which kinds I like, and those happen to be the kind she uses a lot. Like, she really gravitates to a lot of the variegated. I'm always trying to describe where there's sort of a difference in hue, like pink to purple, but not in light to dark. So she's the one who I blame for now being very interested in things like hedgehog fibers and the wandering flock, as in this. And she's also done some stripey things where I'm just obsessed with the color combos that she picked. Like, her sense of color is just so good. She's also often knitting a lot of patterns that I have never seen before, because she knits the vast majority of her projects from the Sandness Garn pattern booklets, which, I mean, at least the ones she picks, they're so stunning. Like, they really look like things you would just buy in a store and no one would ever be the wiser. But I am kind of scared off from them, in part because of watching her podcast, because she often will talk about how, you know, in part because it's this like printed booklet, they are written very concisely. And like perhaps too concisely sometimes. So there are often things she's having to kind of figure out on her own, because it's not really explaining exactly how you're supposed to like keep this stitch pattern going as the stitches increase or decrease or whatever. Just things where it's really kind of expecting you to have the skill set to fill in the blanks, which just makes me a little nervous. And also just because I think these patterns can be a bit harder to track down depending on where in the world you are and what your like local yarn stores stock and things like that. These patterns just tend to have way fewer projects on Ravelry. So as far as being able to like go look at other people's experience and see if someone else had the same problem and if they wrote about how they fixed it, like there's just a lot less potential for that in the patterns that she's knitting. But it is so fun to see patterns that are different from the ones that I'm seeing all over YouTube and that are so beautiful and so polished. Like, I just, what I would give for her knitted wardrobe. Like, it's just incredible. And yeah, like I said, she has three kids, at least three kids. I can picture three of them from her project photos. So if you're also knitting for kids a lot, she has that going as well. All right, next up, we have our Best in Pattern Roundup. So this is going to be knitted by Whitney. Now, Whitney is my second fellow Canadian on the list, because Whitney is based in Nova Scotia. She currently has around 5,500 subscribers, and she's generally knitting around a size XL or 2XL.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Knitted by Whitney YouTube channel. This is a bit of a different video for me, because for the first time ever, I'm doing a planning video.
And the reason that I found Whitney is because of her incredible pattern roundups. One of these landed on my homepage, and I think it was like 50 free size inclusive patterns. And she has done multiple of these like ginormous roundup videos, and just the amount of work that goes into searching for that number of patterns that are not only free, which is a huge limiting factor as we know, but also size inclusive. Like, as someone who has made a conscious decision to not knit things that don't come in a large enough size range, because I would rather be platforming the designers who've gone to the effort of doing that, like, I can tell you how many times I've been like, oh my god, yes, perfect pattern, can't wait to cast this on, I think I want to do this next, and then I go, oh no, it only goes up to like a 49 inch bust. So I just like cannot even fathom the amount of work that goes into putting that kind of video together. And she does such a fantastic job. And again, it means that she's showing patterns that are not like the same 20 patterns that we just see over and over again on knitting YouTube. And like, no shade of those patterns or the people who knit them. Like, again, the podcast that I told you I watch first is one that's covering all kinds of petite knit stuff. So it's not anything against that. It's just that it is so nice to have the variety of also having people in your feed who are showing you different things. Whitney also tends to work with some really colorful, really fun variegated yarns, as well as some more classic neutral stuff. So she really kind of covers the bases, and she also does some color work as well. She's also written a really fantastic article that I highly recommend checking out about size inclusivity and patterns, and sort of the empowerment of being able to knit a garment to fit your body rather than having to find a garment that your body fits into. It's really well written. It's a great read. Highly recommend. All right, next we have Best in Textures and Colorwork. And this is Haley at Knit Weekend. So Haley's based in Nashville, and she's generally knitting between a size extra small or a small, and her channel is currently sitting at about 5,000 subscribers.
Hey, I'm Haley, and you have stumbled upon the Knit Weekend podcast, which is really just my space to nerd out about all things knitting and fiber.
So Haley, tone-wise, I would say sits kind of somewhere between a low-key Sarah Lily Makes and the bubbliness of AKA Nora Knits. Haley is sort of right in the middle of those things. Like, she is somehow both very kind of relaxing and calming, but is also, like, a little bit giggly and doesn't take herself too seriously. So she's another one that I put on, and it just feels like we're just sitting down to hang out like friends. Haley also has her cat, Sweet George Brown, who has a lot of opinions of her own that she likes to chime in with, and that's always a delight. So in her garments, like I said, Haley tends to do a lot of very textured stuff and a lot of color work stuff, and she's generally doing that within a sort of neutral or earth tone kind of palette, which, like, have I ever knit anything in an earth tone? Like, Haley and I knit very different things. And so I think the fact that I enjoy her podcast, despite the fact that we have completely different knitting styles, like, I have also never even done any stranded color work, I think that's a testament to Haley's appeal. And if you are a person who's knitting more of the kinds of stuff she's knitting, all the more reason that I think you should check her out. All right, next up, we have Most Wanted for a Comeback. So this is Maressa Made by Kayla, who lives in Maryland. She has about 11,000 subscribers, and she's generally knitting between a size extra small or a small. And tragically, she hasn't posted a video in about 9 months.
Ooh, it's been a long time. Hi, everybody. I am definitely going to have to take these glasses off because the anime manga vibe is strong again.
But here's the thing. When I was sitting down to make this list of my favorite podcasts, she still popped into my head because I love her and I miss her. And I honestly didn't feel like it had been that long since I had seen an episode of hers. I was generally surprised when I went and checked her channel. But this is one where I'm absolutely hoping for a comeback. And even if one doesn't happen, she has a great archive of videos that would make for a few days of really good binging. Last year she did Vlogmas. There are some really great videos from that. And part of the reason why I feel like I can hold on to hope a little bit longer that she will come back eventually is because in past videos, she has talked a lot about mental health and burnout. So I'm just kind of hoping that she's just in kind of a burnout phase right now and tending to her mental health, and hopefully might be back with more videos in the future. Fingers crossed. And Kayla, if you end up seeing this, I really hope you're doing well, and I love your videos. You're amazing. So for me, the reason Kayla's been so memorable and deserves her spot on this list, even though she's not active right now, is she's just an absolute joy. Like, she's just so giggly and funny. Like, she just sounds like she's having the best time recording. Like, half the time she's just laughing hysterically at herself. I am laughing hysterically with her. It's just such a good time. It always puts me in a better mood. Like, the vibes are just unmatched. She's also into crochet and other crafty things too, so sometimes some of her videos will touch a bit on things other than knitting, but they're mostly knitting focused. So if you have not yet had the pleasure of watching Maressa Made, please go binge watch her archive because it's amazing. All right, here, Bean, look. This is Bean. Bean is visiting today, and she is much more willing to sit here on this bench beside me while I'm filming than Copper is. So she might just hang out here for a bit. Okay, so next up we have Best in the Nitty Gritty. So this is Knits by Mandy. Now Mandy is based in DC. She currently has about 9,000 subscribers, and she's generally knitting between a size small or medium.
Hello, welcome or welcome back to my channel, Knits by Mandy. My name is Amanda, and today we have the 25th episode of the Knits by Mandy podcast.
Now I'm calling her channel Best in the Nitty Gritty in part because one of her videos is actually what, like, directly inspired me to start making my own knitting podcast. You know, it was something that had kind of very vaguely been in the back of my head as, like, a possibility for a while, but she made a video going through all the numbers and, like, kind of behind the scenes of the first year of her own channel, and it really just made it feel so much more, like, tangible and real to me in a way that I felt like I really understood what I would be getting into. So thank you, Mandy, because if you hadn't made that video, I don't know if I would have made this channel. But beyond just that, she's also done some really great videos revisiting past knits. So for example, she's done a sweater audit where she went through every sweater that she's ever knit, kind of revisiting it and evaluating how those sweaters have kind of served her in her wardrobe in the time since she finished them and what she can kind of learn from that to apply to the future projects that she decides to take on. So I really appreciate that kind of, like, analytical and retrospective lens that she applies to her knitting. Her projects also cover a really broad spectrum as far as what she's knitting them out of. She is primarily a garment knitter, but within that, she kind of covers, like, the full gamut. Like, she knits neutral, she knits color, she knits color work, she knits texture, she knits pattern. Like, she really kind of does a bit of everything. So it's always interesting to see what she decides to do next. And she also just does, like, along the lines of the sweater audit or the behind the scenes of her channel, she just does a lot of videos that are breaking out of the traditional podcast format that are always so interesting. Like, she did a video about what she calls knit flips, where she takes something that she's previously knit and changes something about it so that she'll like it more, which is also very in line with my Fix It Fall knit along that I'm running right now. I'll pop up a link to my video about that if you want to learn more and join me for some Fix It Fall. And she's also done some really fun pattern roundups where each one is inspired by a different TV show. So for example, she did one for Gilmore Girls, which I absolutely love, which may come as no surprise if you are a person who has noted that I speak quickly. And you know, sometimes I don't love when podcasts start really breaking out of the traditional knitting podcast format. Sometimes I'm like, I just liked it when you just talked about what you were knitting. But Mandy always seems to do it in a way that I really, really love, and her videos always really appeal to me. Okay, last but not least, we have our best brand new podcast. So in the interest of paying things forward, I want to shout out a brand new channel. She just posted her very first video, and this is Angela's Creative Corner. Now, I'm not really sure like what little miracle of the YouTube algorithm put her on my homepage, because when she ended up on my homepage, there were like maybe 50 views on her video. At the time of filming right now, she has about 100, and she's also a fellow Canadian. She's based in Alberta. I think she's generally knitting around a size small, and her first video is going over all of her recent finished objects. So it's sort of a part one, and the part two is going to be like the whips and acquisitions part of things.
All right, so welcome to my YouTube channel. So my name is Angela. I'm a knitter that lives in Alberta, Canada.
She seems to knit kind of a combo of colorful things and more neutral things. So like I said, she only has one video up right now, but I immediately subscribed because I just really like her vibe. I feel like podcasts tend to evolve a lot very quickly from their very first episode, and I'm just really excited to see where her channel goes. I love the way that she uses text on screen to sort of like make fun of herself from her editing self to her footage self. I truly love her sense of humor. And I just, you know, sometimes you get a feeling that you're like in on the ground floor of something really good. And I feel like this is that, and I'm truly excited to see where her channel goes. So I highly recommend going to check her out and subscribing. All right, that's all I've got for you today. So next time I should be back with a regular podcast episode. But in the meantime, thank you so much for coming in with me. If you'd like to be here again next time, I hope you'll consider subscribing if you're not already. But if you are, you're my favorite. And I'll see you next time. Bye.